But they had a church, the church of Ephesus. And in Acts chapter 20, Paul gives a farewell address, but knowing they would never see him again. They knew this. Paul made it clear to them. This was the last time they were going to see the Apostle Paul. Chapter 20, this was written around AD 57. Now I'll tell you in a second why that's important. In verse 17 of chapter 20, Paul called the elders, presbyterios, the elders of the church. He called the elders of the church, the elders, synonymous with overseer, synonymous with shepherd or pastor. They're the leaders of the church. He calls them together. He called them together. It's their job to instruct the flock. It's their job. Verse 25, I know that all of you among whom I went about preaching the kingdom will no longer see my face. Therefore, I testify to you this day that I'm innocent of the blood of all men. For I did not shrink from declaring to you the whole purpose of God. So he's innocent of the blood of all men. You know what that means? Probably alluding to Ezekiel 33. Which the Lord said, if you see the sword coming and you don't warn the people, if you see the sword coming and you don't warn the people, God will hold their blood on your hands. If you see false teachings, false teachers, people that are damaging people in the church, and you don't warn the people, God will hold their blood on your hands because you didn't do your job. Paul says, I'm innocent of all men's blood because I declared the entirety of Scripture to you. Today, too many times, we see that parts of Scripture are declared, and people tend to stay away from the offensive parts of the Scripture, like the parts about moral defects, the parts about sin and wrath, the parts about God requires sacrifice before he will pardon somebody. The parts about homosexuality, about murder, even honoring your parents. I mean, people stay away from those topics or speaking out. We need to preach, even as Christians, the entirety of the counsel of God. Paul says, because I do this, I'm innocent of the blood of all men. Verse 28, he says to the elders, be on guard for yourself and the flock. Be on guard for yourself and the flock among which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers to shepherd, poimen, in Latin that's pastor. The word here is shepherd, or one that guards. One of the primary functions of a pastor is to guard, according to Paul. Guard the flock. Guard them against moral issues, on moral issues, and guard them against doctrinal errors. That's just the job. Paul says, guard yourself, because God, the Holy Spirit, put you here, which he purchased with his own blood. Great deity of Christ passage. I know after my departure, verse 29, savage wolves will come in. Not sparing the flock from your own selves, men will arise speaking perverse things to draw disciples after them. Therefore, be on alert. Remember that for night and day, for a period of 3 years, I did not cease to admonish each one of you with tears. Be on alert. Because he knows savage wolves are going to come in. And they're not going to spare the flock. How can we tell a wolf? How do we know what a wolf looks like? Well, they don't look like wolves. They look like sheep, says Christ. right? They talk like sheep, they act like sheep, they smell like sheep. But we're called to be fruit inspectors, and there's fruits of doctrine that we have to examine. And when the doctrine is not consistent with the scripture, it's our job. Well, if we love people, we're going to tell them. But that's what a wolf is. And Paul's talking about the wolves from within the church. See, there's wolves from without. Like people look at Muslims, Jehovah's Witnesses, and these groups. But then there's the wolves from within. And that's what Paul is dealing with here. Savage wolves will come in and they don't care. They won't. They're not going to spare the flock. And Paul says, I warned you for 3 years about this, about the wolves from within the church. For 3 years, I warned you night and day with tears. Was he passionate?
Yeah.
Was he concerned about his flock? Yeah. He's telling the elders this. Guys, watch out for the wolves within the church. They could be sitting right next to you. You got to check out the doctrine. So passionate, Paul says, for 3 years I warned you. Night and day, all the time, with tears. He was passionate. Now I can imagine Paul got up. He was here today and he got up at some of the, you know, big church and starts warning about the wolves. I don't think they let him speak for 5 minutes before they would throw him out. Here's a question. Did the church of Ephesus, the elders, did they listen? Did they listen to Paul? 3 years, night and day with tears. Did they listen? Well, we have the answer, and it's found in Revelation chapter 2. Now, Revelation, perhaps written maybe 70. Some people view it written later. I believe all the books were written before 70 AD. Nevertheless, it was at least 10 or 15 years after Paul gave him this warning. Listen to what he says. He, Jesus tells the pastors of seven churches. He has some nice things to say, and he has some not so nice things to say to the pastors. Most churches, these churches, the seven churches in Revelation were heavily rebuked by Christ himself. But they also had, he had great things to say about them, and he also had some rebukes. Dealing with the church of Ephesus and the question, did they listen? Verse 2 of Revelation 2. Jesus says, I know your deeds. I know your deeds. That means he knows our works, whether we're alone or not, good or bad. He knows. Oh, he knows. He says, I know your deeds and your toil and perseverance that you cannot tolerate evil men. Today, we see this doctrine of toleration. It's just tolerate. It's just tolerate whatever comes. We don't want to leave the church. Let's just tolerate their sin. Let's just tolerate their falsities. This church was commended by Christ, God in the flesh, for not tolerating evil men. And their toil and perseverance in this area. This word for toil, kapos, in the Greek text. It's a toil of labor, from laborious work involving fatigue, deep fatigue. I know your deeds, says Christ, and your deep fatigue, your pain in this area. And your perseverance. You cannot tolerate evil men. You put to the test those who call themselves apostles, wolves from within. And they are not, and you found them to be false. And you have persevered and endured for my name. And you have not grown weary. You have not grown weary. So, these elders, the church, they actually found apostles false. And they could not tolerate falsities, false teachers or false teachings. And what does Jesus do? How dare you speak against anyone? Shame. No. God in the flesh, Jesus Christ, commends them for doing so. Today, if you do that, you get ridiculed. Jesus commended them for finding apostles false. He said, good job, because that's what I want you to do. Paul devoted his life, his entire life, to the area of confronting error and affirming doctrine, guarding for it. In Acts 17:16, when Paul was in Athens, it says his spirit was being provoked, peruxeno, stirred up within him as he was observing a city of idols. We as Christians should be stirred up when we come face to face with idolatry in any form. We should get stirred up because the Spirit of God lives in us, and the Spirit of God gets stirred up. Paul's ministry life reflected in his God-inspired writings. Theopneustos, God-breathed out writings. His life is reflected in affirming and defending apologetics, the faith. That's the exact reason why he was under chains, that we read in Philippians chapter 1, verse 7 to 16. Since both in my imprisonment and my apologia, defense, and confirmation of the gospel, you are all partakers of grace with me. They were doing the same thing. And I'm appointed, in verse 16, Paul said, I'm appointed for the Greek word apologia of the gospel. He says, I'm appointed for the apologetics. As all of us are appointed and commanded to do so. That's our job. Whether you're a teacher, leader, or avid Christian, to openly defend and affirm the truth, refute false doctrine, be bold like the pastors of Ephesus who were commended by Christ. It's commanded of all of us. We saw in 1 Peter 3:15, always, you, Christians, all of you, always be ready to give an answer. To give a reason for the faith that you have, the hope that's in you. Always be ready. God doesn't care about convenience, he cares about obedience. Obedience. In Jude 1:3, we read, under divine inspiration, behold, while I was making every effort to write to you about our common salvation, keep in mind, Peter and Jude were letters to all the churches. They're universal letters. Jude says, I felt necessary to write to you, appealing that you contend earnestly for the faith. Epagunizomai, contend earnestly, comes from epi and agon. Epi, upon, that's what that word means, upon. In the other words, a compound Greek word translated contend earnestly. And the second part of the word is agon, which means contest, contend. In fact, the word agon is the root word for agony. Agony. A focus upon agony. Contend for the faith. Stand up, be bold. Remember the pastors at Ephesus where Jesus Christ himself commended them for their deep fatigue in finding apostles false. Thus, biblically, we're commanded to confront biblical error and agony. Don't run from it. You're supposed to do it. I have a friend named, you might have heard of him, Robert Morey. He's an apologist, he's written a lot of books. And he calls those, particularly leaders, who they're careful not to offend anyone, he calls them evangelifish. Can't have any more fear. Those days are over. We can't be fearful. Biblically, this is what we're supposed to do. But what if our confrontation, what if our standing up for truth, What if our affirming the truth and confronting error, what if that offends people? Then what are we supposed to do? What are we supposed to do? Well, truth, we have to understand, will always be offensive for those that don't embrace it. It's always going to be offensive. Both Jesus and Paul, well, guess what? They offended everybody. They were the most offensive people. And Jesus was incarnate love. Yet he can say to the Pharisees, you whitewash walls. The gospel offended Paul before he was saved, when he was Saul. It offends. What we got to do, what Scripture says, not what our feelings say. We got to stand up for truth and let God worry about the results. I'm innocent of all man's blood, Paul says, because I declare the entirety of Scripture to you. And if you want people, strangers, or loved ones, if you want them to stay in biblical error, if you want them to keep being deceived by someone, just don't say anything. Be silent. You'll please them. But at the expense of your disobedience to the Lord, you'll please them. Because they won't be mad. Galatians 1:10, again speaking in context of Judaizers, Paul tells the people who are probably very upset at his refutation of false teachings. Paul says, "For I'm now seeking the favor of men or of God? Am I seeking the favor of men or God? Or am I striving to please men? If I were still trying to please men, I would not be a bondservant of Christ." If you're trying to please men, you are not, according to Paul, a bondservant of Christ, because you're afraid. You're afraid what people will think. You're afraid how people will look at you. You're pleasing men. But don't call yourself a bondservant of Christ. Paul's point. We heard a marvelous set of passages this morning in Matthew 7, 15 following, about the wise man and the foolish man. Jesus again speaking, he says, "Beware. Beware." Cross echo. Bear to mind or devote your attention to false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing. But inwardly, they're really bad. They're ravenous wolves. Watch out for them. How do you watch out for them? What if you're just embracing them? If I see you embracing them and I don't say anything, what does Ezekiel 33 say? If you see the sword coming, you don't warn the people, God will hold their blood in your hands. My job as a Christian, aside from what I do for a living as a Christian, if I love you, I'm going to tell you. Because I'm going to tell you out of love and obedience. Beware of false prophets. Jesus says, watch out for them, because they look like sheep. And they deceive people. Many will come to me on that day and will say, Lord, Lord, did we prophesy in your name, cast out demons, perform many signs and wonders, miracles, showing that the false teachers can perform signs and wonders, at least counterfeit signs and wonders. And Jesus said, depart from me, I never knew you. You who practice lawlessness. So he says, beware of the false teacher or the false prophet. But then he says in verse 24, everyone, he's talking to his disciples, then he says, everyone who acts on these things, who hears these words of mine and acts on them, not who hears these words and says, well, that's nice, and says nothing, does not act upon them. He says, the ones that act upon them, well, they're wise men, because they built their house in Rome. And he says in verse 26, everyone who does hear these things, we heard these things this morning. And he says, if you hear these things, Jesus says, and you don't act like them, on them, you don't act upon it. How do you act upon it? Well, you watch out. Tell people, you act upon it. You refute error, you confront it, you affirm truth out of love, obedience. He says, if you don't act upon it, you're a foolish man. Because your house is built on quicksand. Everything falls. You can't stand for anything. We cannot allow our feelings to dictate our actions. We must be truth lovers. Submit to the Lord's method of dealing with error. And quit trying to make your own feelings the authority. God knows what he's doing. In 1 Timothy 5, verse 15, Paul deals with the elders again. He says, those who continue to sin rebuke the presence of all, in order that the rest also will be fearful of sinning. He says rebuke. If there's an elder, remember the early church was ran by elders, a plurality of elders or pastors. But Paul says, if one of them keeps sinning, rebuke them in front of the other elders, in front of all of them, so the others will take warning. These are God's instructions. Here's what you do. Take it or leave it. If you leave it, you're in disobedience to me. You're an act of rebellion because you're afraid. You got to be strong. Titus 1:9, Paul says, refute those who oppose sound doctrine. That's what God told Titus through Paul, us, through the scriptures to do. Refute means showing the error. Because if you love them, you're going to do that. If you don't love them, don't say anything. Don't say you're a bondservant of Christ in good obedience. Paul says in 2 Timothy 2:15, be diligent, present yourself, approved to God as a workman who does not need to be ashamed, but accurately handling the word of truth. Orthotomeo, cutting straight the word of truth. In 2 Timothy 2:16 and 18, remember Timothy was in Ephesus, filled with pagans. It was challenging for pastors because you're surrounded by false teachers, false teachings. Very challenging. But the Lord tells them what to do. Avoid worldly and empty chatter, for it will lead to further ungodliness in verse 17 of chapter 2. Their talk will spread like gangrene, like a cancer. Among them are Hemanias and Philetus. He just mentioned names. Paul mentioned names. Hemanias and Philetus. Because how are you going to warn people if you don't mention who they are, who's causing damage? Hemanias and Philetus were two Gnostics in the church. Men who have gone astray from the truth, saying that the resurrection had already taken place. That's heresy. And they upset the faith of some. They're upsetting people. And Paul mentions names, Hemanias and Philetus. Because that's what God told them to do through the Holy Scripture. 1 Timothy 1:3, as I urge you, upon my departure of Macedonia, you should stay at Ephesus and instruct certain men not to teach false doctrines. We're Christians. We should be bold because our life is not very, very long. Tomorrow's not promised to us. We are Christians. We should make our feelings the ark of truth. But we should put Scripture and look at Scripture as our final authority. And not be concerned if you're going to upset someone. You're a man pleaser. You're not a slave to Christ if you're so upset. Or if you don't want anyone to get upset. And it's the most unloving thing you can do. We're Christians. We must be bold in our faith. Not being afraid. Because we do it out of love. We speak out of love. We warn people out of love and out of obedience. We have divine marching orders in here. We have them in here. Must be our rule of faith, not what we think works. Well, it doesn't work if I say this. But what if I had that attitude with her, with my wife? Well, I kind of like her, so I really didn't want to rock the boat. What if she had that attitude with her family, who she's still dealing with? What? I want to keep everything calm. That is disobedience, because you're afraid. That's disobedience, because God told you what to do. Confront error. Let me worry about the results. I'm the author of salvation, not you. It's not what works or not. The question is, what does Scripture say? We're all Christians. We have marching orders. We got to trust God in these things. I'm going to be commended by Christ. In my refutation, in my confrontation of error, I'm going to be commended, just like the Passion's word Ephesus. And in closing, I'll say two things. The problem is with not saying anything, not speaking out. If my sister over here is being deluded by someone she's following, and I don't tell her, I just say, well, gotta be careful. People let you follow, but I don't tell her who. Well, the false teachings that's damaging her life is gonna be construed as truth. Because I just don't want to offend her. That's not a loving act. That's the most unloving thing I can do, is not mention the name that she's following and say, listen, this is what he's teaching, this is what Scripture says. I'm warning her because Scripture tells me to. Paul named names. Always be ready to give an answer. Always be ready to give a defense and to help others, to warn others, be bold in the faith. Our last passage, secondly, 2 Timothy 4:2, the end of Paul's life. This was his last will and testimony, to say. The last letter he wrote. He was always concerned about false teaching. He was always concerned about, as I said before, the first century church was love and doctrine. Don't confuse love with being silent. Love and doctrine. Paul's main concern in life. Are you loving people? Are you putting people first? Are you preaching the doctrine? Are you confronting error? 2 Timothy 4:2. He says, preach the word, be ready, in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with great patience and instruction. What's very interesting is these verbs, preach, be ready, reprove, rebuke, exhort. These verbs here, five verbs, they're in a particular tense. First, they're in a commandment mood of the verbs, meaning he's commanding Timothy what to do and how to instruct pastors. He's commanding, but it's in an aorist tense. It's an aorist imperative, a snapshot tense, but when you combine that construction, it's the strongest way to stress urgency in a command. It's a do it now commandment. So Paul's saying, do it now, aorist imperative, do it right now. I don't know what you're doing yesterday. I don't know what you did yesterday. I don't know what you're doing tomorrow. But do this right now, preach. Be ready, refute, rebuke, encourage. Make it the most important thing to do, leaders. That's what that tense indicates. A do it now set of commandments. Do this right now. Make this the most important thing you ever do. Why is this urgency? Because the next few verses, 3 and 4, Paul says, well, there's going to come a time when they will not endure sound doctrine. But wanting the ears to be tickled, they'll accumulate teachers to themselves. In accordance to their own desires, they'll turn away from truth. They'll turn toward mythology. So if you don't do this, this is what will happen. Mythology. They'll turn away from truth. You got to be strong. Especially those who lead the church. Leaders. Strong, be strong, or they'll turn away to mythology. Consider this, interesting. Every single New Testament epistle, virtually, was written to refute a particular error. Romans, Ephesians, Galatians, Judaizers, Colossians, 1st and 2nd Peter, 1st and 2nd John, Jude, Gnostics. To undeceive the church, God, the Holy Spirit, found it important to undeceive Christians because we're sheep. We follow a lot of things. We need help. It was important to Paul. And it should be important to us. It should be so important that we should make this a priority. Don't be afraid. We're Christians. Be bold. Let God handle the results. Quit trying to please everyone. Let God handle the results. Always be ready to give an answer, to give a defense for your faith, for the hope that's in you. Always be ready. Jude says, contend earnestly for the faith that was handed down once and for all. Paul promises you in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 that our proclamation, the message of the cross, is going to be what? To those who are perishing. Foolishness. Paul almost guarantees people will be upset when you confront error and affirm the truth. Paul promises you that your message that Jesus Christ is God, it's salvation by work, or apart from works, through faith alone, that's foolishness to those who are perishing. The ones that are going to get upset are the ones who are embracing this error. We got to be strong. The word foolishness there is moron. Paul promises you that your proclamation of the truth is going to be seen as moronic. What are we worried about? Let's do what God tells us to do. Let's be bold. Roaring lions of faith. With that, let's close in prayer. Lord God, we just thank you that we indeed are Christians. And Father, you imputed us with the righteousness of Christ. And thank you, Lord God, that we have the ability to please you, the ability to hear what you wrote. So, Father God, just give us the desire to obey you and to be bold, to be commended by Jesus Christ by finding the apostles false in toil and in perseverance. Let us defend Christ because it glorifies him. Thank you, Lord God, you give us this opportunity. Let us all pray for each other. Let us put others first. And let us not be afraid. Let us be slaves of Christ. Because that's really all that matters in this life. As Paul says, for me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. In the name of Christ the Lord Jesus, our God, our Savior, our eternal priest, second person of the Trinity, who we worship. In his name, amen.
Well, if that doesn't make us bold, I don't know. So, our last song is number 227. Please stand as we sing There's Something About That Man.